we've been working our way through the Old Testament over the summer months, and there's been wars and battles and naughty deeds and all sorts of things. But today's reading kind of reminds us to play, to dance and play and love, and love each other. And so that's what we're going to do today. It's a beautiful day, and we're going to go out. So we're going to say a little prayer first. Lord, we thank you for the invitation to love and play and be joyful. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Our worship continues on page 67 of the small book on your pews. Pray together. Almighty God,
unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may worthy of thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ said, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and write both these thy laws in our hearts, we beseech thee. Thank you.
The lesson is written in the Song of Solomon, beginning at the second verse. I am a rose of Sharon, a lily of the valleys. As a lily among brambles, so is my love among maidens. As an apple tree among the trees of the wood, so is my beloved among young men. With great delight I sat in his shadow, and his fruit was sweet to my taste. He brought me to the banqueting house, and his intention towards me was love. Sustain me with raisins, refresh me with apples, for I am filled with love. Oh, that his left hand were under my head, and that his right hand embraced me. I adjure you, O daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles or the wild doves, do not stir up our waking love until it is ready. The voice of my beloved, look, he comes, leaping upon the mountains, bounding over the hills. My beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag. Look, there he stands behind our wall, gazing in at the windows, looking through the lattice. My beloved speaks and says to me, arise, my love, my fair one, and come away. For now the winter is past, the rain is over and gone. The flowers appear on the earth, the time of singing has come, and the voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. The fig tree puts forth its figs, and the vines are in blossom. They give forth fragrance. Arise, my love, my fair one, and come away. Oh, my dove, in the clefts of the rock, in the coverts of the cliff, let me see your face. Let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet, and your face is lovely. Catch us, the foxes, the little foxes that ruin the vineyards, for our vineyards are in blossom. My beloved is mine, and I am his. He pastures his flock among the lilies until the day breaks and the shadows flee. Turn, my beloved, be like a gazelle or a youngster on the cliff mountains. Here ended the lesson.
Please join in the reading of Psalm 45, found on page 386. Of the Burgundy Prayer Book in the Blue Rack. My heart overflowing with a good matter, I recite my verses for the King.
My tongue is the hand of the ready writer.
Thou art fairer than the children of men.
Full of grace are thy lips, therefore God hath blessed thee forever.
Gird thee with thy sword upon thy thigh, O mighty one.
According to thy glory and thy majesty.
And in thy majesty ride on to victory in the cause of truth and of meekness and righteousness.
And let thy right hand teach us the arrow of kings.
Thy arrows are very sharp in the heart of the king's enemies.
And they will strike securely upon thee.
endureth forever.
Scepter of thy kingdom is a Christ's scepter.
Thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity.
Wherefore God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness upon thy house.
All thy garments smell of myrrh, aloes, and cassia.
Out of thy great house of stringed instruments take thee now.
King's daughters are among thy honorable women.
Upon thy right hand dost stand, leading the vesture of gold.
Hearken, O daughter, consider, and incline thy ear.
For they are also thy own people and thy father's house.
So shall the king have pleasure in thy beauty.
Since he is thy Lord, bow thou down to him.
And the daughter of Tyre shall be there with a gift.
Even the rich among the people shall entreat thy favor.
The king's daughter within the palace is all glorious.
Her clothing is profitable.
She is brought to the king in raiment of needlework.
The virgins that meet her fellows bear her company and are brought to the king.
With joy and gladness are they led along.
As they enter into the king's house.
Instead of thy fathers, thou shalt have sons.
Whom thou mayest name princes from all over the earth.
I will make thy name to be remembered from one generation to another.
Therefore shall none praise thee, world without end.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be.
The epistle is taken from the letter of James, beginning at the first verse. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes in the dispersion, greetings. My brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of any kind, consider it nothing but joy, because you know that the testing of your faith produces endurance, and let endurance have its full effect, so that you may be mature and complete, lacking in nothing. If any of you is lacking in wisdom, ask God who gives to all generously and ungrudgingly, and it will be given you. But ask in faith, never doubting. For the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For the doubter, being double-minded and unable in every way, must not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Let the believer who is lowly boast in being raised up, and the rich in being brought low. Because the rich will disappear like a flower in the field. For the sun rises with its scorching heat and withers the field. Its flower falls and its beauty perishes. It is the same with the rich. In the midst of a busy life, they will wither away. Blessed is anyone who endures temptation. Such a one has stood the test and will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. No one, when tempted, should say, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself tempts no one. But one is tempted by one's own desire, being lured and enticed by it. Then, when that desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and that sin, when it is fully grown, gives birth to death. Do not be deceived, my beloved. Every generous act of giving with every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, He gave us birth by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for your anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted truth word that has the power to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in the mirror. For they look at themselves and, on going away, immediately forget what they were like. But those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If anything, they are religious, and do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. Here endeth the epistle.
Stand as we sing hymn 349.
Glory to you, Lord. Now when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders. They do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups, pots, and bronze kettles. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" Jesus said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines.' You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition." Then Jesus called the crowd again and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile. For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come. Fornication, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, folly. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
On page 71, we say together, "I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, through whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again in glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and his Son, who with the Father and his Son together is worshipped and glorified, who saith by the prophets. And I believe in the Holy Catholic Mass of the Church. I acknowledge my baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Well, after reading St. James, first chapter, 22nd verse, To be a doer of the word, not merely a hearer. There was a part of me that wanted to put down my keyboard, I suppose it once would have been the pen, and go off and make a lasagna for my neighbor in need, and just generally commend to you to read the scripture and do something good. But that wouldn't quite fly, would it? So I carried on, and I have these words for you today, and more on the lasagna in just a minute. But it begins with St. James pointing out that the mere hearing is not easy. In fact, it's quite difficult. We have in our lives temptation, we have in our lives trials, and we often fail them. He speaks this morning in the text read by Catherine of being moved to and fro on the sea and being doubters and not hearing the word, not focusing upon the word, being distracted. We live in the age of distraction, do we not? With our wonderful smartphones ever beckoning. And then there are the temptations. The temptations to blame God for what's not taking us to the word rather than our own follies. The temptation of the rich that St. James points out. Our grasping and our striving towards position. He says something. In the midst of a busy life, we, brackets, the rich, will wither away. That one kind of got me. I don't know if any of you are consumed by your pre-winter to-do list. Does it go off in your mind like one of those scratches in the old, this dates me, the old records that you'd have a scratch and go back and say it over and over again, and that's going in my mind, that I have all these things to do that seem so important. There's the blackened piece of fascia that greets me every time I walk in the door. I look to the right near the eavestropping where the water comes off and it's rotting. And all I can think of is that I have to rent scaffolding, but how can I do that in a way that I won't pay the double week fare? And how is this all going to be worked out in life that it's going to be okay? Or the secondhand car I need for my next appointment to drive out to Lower Sackville, or the hole in the ground that I dug earlier this year to take out the gout weed that I've not addressed so that the gout weed will just come back next spring. And so it goes, all of the to-do lists that are rattling around our brains, this busyness that does not allow us somehow to hear the word of God and therefore to do God's will. So what's the antidote? Well, oddly, I found the Song of Solomon to be an antidote. Joy, as my wife pointed out as she led the children outside. To hear God, to hear God's word calls for joy sometimes. Deep joy. Eros springing gazelle-like towards us in the Song of Solomon. The lover's poem. It is a lover's poem. We have lover's poems in the Bible, folks. Is that not wonderful? In a female voice. Look, he comes, leaping over the mountains, bounding over the hills. My beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag. I hope my wife can see me in that way at times. Is that not a bad thing? I think that is a good thing. The inclusion in the wisdom literature of these love poems seems to simply make the point human love can be and often is beautiful. It's not an evil thing to see beauty and wonder in another human being. James has beautiful words. We are to recall we're birthed from truth. Birthed by who? By God. From truth. That we might be a kind of first fruits of God's creation. The song is a reminder that the Bible is aware of deep longings we have deep within. Similarly, the love of God for us is not dry, it is not superficial. This is what Jesus is saying in our gospel to these religious authorities that he is critiquing. God's love, my friends, is deep. It's uncontained. It is full. It is not these exterior signs you are speaking of. Even in deepest sorrow and grief, my friends, I hope that you can try to feel a little hint of that deep belovedness for you. Chris Oddie is a parishioner, was a parishioner, he died recently. His sermons were rich and melodious and full of that love. On June 2, 2019, on Ascension Sunday, Chris said in one of his sermons, "If Christ was willing to take on our humanity while still remaining God, surely that tells us that God values us as physical human beings. And it also suggests that heaven and earth are not so far apart as we might imagine." The wisdom of a saint. Understanding and embracing that we are God's first fruits, that we are given birth by him in truth. That's helping me, anyway, answer the question of how to open our ears to God's word, to let it come into us, that understanding of our belovedness. However, as James also suggests, when he says we must not be forgetful hearers, the inverse of forgetful is remembrance. We need to remember to practice what our faith teaches us. It needs to be habitus, it needs to be habitual. Which brings me back, as promised, to my lasagna. I read James, I prayed. In prayer, my neighbor came to me, who has lost a father, deals with sickness in her family. I remembered her. I stopped writing this sermon, and I went to the store, and I bought the ingredients, and I did the lasagna, trusting some words would come for this sermon this morning, and also that in God's grace and mercy, the termites would find another place, a piece of wood to eat, but my rotten fascia for another day. And in God's grace and mercy, I do believe that to be the case. None of this is to boast of making the lasagna or any virtue. Lord knows how many times I've not done it. It's simply to tell you my understanding of James's duo of hearing and doing and how they interact. I'm sure you can think of examples in your own lives. It seems we are to create a pattern of listening to the word and then through prayer reflexively reacting to consciousness of suffering around us. We should recall that the early churches are our models and how this should work. Sometimes in ways that are extraordinary. May 2003, a group of people who lived on the outskirts of the community of Carthage, Christians, are rounded up, brought to jail for their faith, then sold to a circus where they are to be the entertainment. But the problem for the citizenry is that they are expecting the criminals who are usually sold and injured by the gladiators and wild animals to cringe before they die. But the Christians have the habitus, they have formed through prayer and through action, a reaction. It's not, they don't know what's going to happen to them. They're just walking out there and reacting reflexively. What do they do according to the account of 2003 in the Passion of Saint Perpetua, who was one of those who died? After their injuries, they gathered in the center, and just as we do, they passed the peace to one another before they died. It was so powerful and so evocative that the account tells us that the guard became a convert. And so it goes through the centuries. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, 1930s, as Germany descends into the barbarity of National Socialism, he gathers 25 vicars in the countryside for training. He writes a book about it called Life Together. Again, it's not very long if you want to read it sometime. It's just a discussion of the patterns and practices, the habits of the Christian community, how we live together. And again, the pattern of daily prayer and work and how it meshes and flows together. On this Labor Day, I read and quote from him, "The prayer of the Christian reaches beyond its set time and extends into the heart of his or her work each day. It includes the whole day and thus does not hinder the work but promotes it, affirms it, and lends it meaning and joy." Now perhaps your equivalent of lasagna making, whatever it may be, a visit to a friend who is ill, a few dollars in donation, the creation of a park bench. I saw one the other day saying Amazing Grace on it. Whatever it is, may seem like small potatoes compared to the embodied acts of the martyrs. But you know, often it all begins with these small acts of our hands. And it's powered and formed by the habits of faith in Jesus Christ, who lived and died and was resurrected for us. It's emboldened by the sense of being beloved by God. And those are the things that help us then to open our ears to the word of God, that we may do his will. Amen. Amen.
Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Our offertory hymn, number 619.
Oh,
us pray for God's world and all God's people.